and we have to really escalate the noise we make so that we'll be heard. Welcome to Gay USA. I'm Andy Humm.
I'm Ann Northrop.
And a happy Thanksgiving to you.
Yes. Not so happy with the Trump administration, though. I mean, it's been a week when everything's gone to hell with the Trump administration, but it gets worse.
Yes, because they're now pushing 4-H clubs to drop LGBT inclusive policies.
Who even knew that 4-H clubs had a connection to the federal government, but it turns out they do. In California, however, in the most recent elections, and we'll bring you more election results, they have elected their first out gay statewide elected official.
And with the Democrats taking over in the U.S. House, they're allowed to set new rules, and that's going to include non-discrimination and a big diversity push.
But back to the Trump administration, Education Secretary Betsy DeVos wants to make it easier for students to sexually harass each other.
And Canada wants the new NAFTA.
The USMCA.
The new NAFTA. they want it to include LGBT rights, but right-wing U.S. members of Congress are trying to stop that.
Yeah. A man in Arkansas, a scary man in Arkansas, is charged with threatening repeatedly out gay CNN anchor Don Lemon.
And others. A gay council member in Texas is fighting his recall.
That's a sad story. Demonstrations took place for LGBT rights in Chile, Taiwan, and the Ukraine.
And our guest is Rob Shooter, here to tell us about his new radio show, Radio Rob, and to dish entertainment news from Frankie Grande's sexuality to how Paul McCartney has become a regular at a New York City gay bar.
Wow.
And free speech.
Free Speech TV, which carries us nationally and is a great partner to us, is going into another one of their pledge drives for the next month. So from November 29th to December 23rd, we will premiere on those stations or satellite networks on Fridays at 8:30 p.m. Eastern, and we'll repeat on Sundays at 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. Eastern. Regularly scheduled programming on those outlets will resume on December 24th.
You have all that down?
Well, if not, subscribe to our newsletter, and it'll have all the details.
It will. The 4-H clubs. It's been so long since I've thought about them, I didn't even remember what it stood for. Head, heart, hands, and health. I also didn't know it was created by Congress in 1914. But, you know, like a lot of groups, like the Boy Scouts and others, and the Girl Scouts, they're trying to make some progress around LGBT issues, and they develop sort of guidance for chapters about inclusion. And 8 states adopted them, put them on their websites and things, but
then the U.S. Department of Agriculture, which it turns out has oversight over this federally chartered organization, said, no, 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 we don't want you to have LGBT inclusive policies. Our Secretary Sonny Perdue is against this, so you have to get rid of those. So the state director of the 4-H in Iowa stood up and said, no, we are an inclusive organization, and I am sticking up for these principles.
His name is John Paul Chason Cardenas. He's the first Latino statewide director of the 4-H, and he was vigorously defending the inclusion policy.
Yes.
So they fired him.
Yep.
It's outrageous.
Now,
he said, look, I'm for all the kids.
Yep. Now, of course, all of this from the federal government was provoked by what? Complaints from the Christian right. It is the evangelical Christian right at work again, and the administration bowing down to them and giving them exactly what they want in all areas of life.
Well, this is why I had chest pains on election night 2016, because all knew all these things would happen. And look, when Obama was in power, the NGLTF spent a lot of time looking through all the policies of the federal government and saying, let's make them more inclusive, let's make them better. Now you got a group of people saying, let's make it worse.
Well, you can tell how far right-wing this complaint is because Chuck Grassley, senator from Iowa.
You may remember him from the Kavanaugh hearings, presiding over them.
And making sure Kavanaugh got confirmed. Chuck Grassley is upset about this and thinks this is something that needs some looking into. HRC is looking into it by filing a Freedom of Information Act request for all the files on this. They want to see all that correspondence between the evangelicals and the Family Research Council and all these people to the Agriculture Department about this.
They are, however, beyond embarrassment.
Well, that's true.
And Alliance Defending Freedom, which probably was behind this as well, is asking the Supreme Court to overturn a trans-inclusive policy at Boyerton Senior High School, upheld by the Third Circuit. They want to force trans people into single-use facilities at schools.
And the right wing is at work against the new provision of the new USMCA. That's the United States, Mexico, and Canada. The NAFTA replacement trade agreement, which everyone agrees is really kind of a nothing burger, as they say, but Trump touts as the greatest invention since sliced bread. Have I made all my food analogies?
It's Thanksgiving.
Well, it turns out that Canada, in agreeing to this new trade pact, insisted on a provision that said countries must promote inclusion and diversity and non-discrimination, but including for sexual orientation and gender identity.
Let's just say they slipped it in. They put it in there.
Yep.
There was a question about what kind of force of law it would have. But now Trudeau is being questioned about it, and he's not saying...
He's not saying anything.
The treaty will rise or fall on this.
The right wing has gotten 38 members of the United States House of Representatives to send a letter to Trump saying, you can't sign this agreement with this in it.
It's insulting to our sovereignty.
So it'll be very interesting because this is all supposed to come to a head at the G20 meeting in Argentina at the end of this month, just a week away. And that's where these three countries are supposed to sign on to this agreement. So we'll see in the next week whether it gets changed or not, and whether it blows up the agreement.
I mean, it was 40 bigots in the Congress that objected to this, mainly people like Steve King, Vicky Hartzler,
yes,
and Louis
Gohmert.
Gohmert.
The handmaidens to the evangelicals.
Yes. All right, and then there's Betsy DeVos. So we've talked about this a lot, but the Ed Department is issuing its guidelines for dealing with sexual harassment, and there's a comment period, so you can try to stop this by making comments, but they're retreating on sexual harassment under Title IX. They want more protections for the accused. We're all for protections for the accused.
Absolutely.
But schools...
Due process.
But a school only has to investigate now if the incident takes place on campus. So it softens the Obama rules. Wait a minute. Here's the phrase. They're saying the harassment would have to be so severe, pervasive, and objectively offensive that it effectively denies a person equal access to the school's education program or activity.
Do they have to have 6 witnesses, too?
Half of them have to be men or something like that. I don't know. It's
crazy. All right, a couple more things. Trump is still nominating anti-LGBT and specifically American Bar Association designated unqualified candidates to the federal judiciary.
Now, Jeff Flake this week said he's not going to vote for anybody in committee or on the floor if they don't protect Mueller. But what's her name from Maine?
Susan Collins.
Said, I'm not, it doesn't bother me.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that means they can get it through on the floor.
Yeah, but here's my last footnote. You may or may not have seen the Clinton Affair documentary on A&E this week. 7 hours in 3 nights. It was fascinating. fascinating. You absolutely must watch it if you missed it.
Okay, okay.
It's available on demand. I'm sure they'll repeat it. But the one of the best moments was they're talking about the right-wing plot, and it really was a plot to get Clinton by bringing up, you know, they tried with the Whitewater stuff and all the crazy deals in Arkansas. That didn't work with Ken Starr, the special prosecutor. So he turns to these women who've all accused him, and they're very credible, and Bill Clinton was a creep, and Monica even used to call him a creep.
We called on him to resign when it first came out.
And he did all sorts of other terrible stuff, but they show this cabal of lawyers working for the right wing, and they were known as the elves. That's what they were known as, the elves.
One of them's on the Supreme Court now.
Brett Kavanaugh. There are shots of young Brett Kavanaugh, and you know, we all knew, we heard during his confirmation hearings that he worked with Ken Starr. But this shows how truly evil and maniacal he is. Oh, my God. And what they did to entrap Monica and put her in an untenable position, it was so evil and so cruel and so horrible. And he was a ringleader in that. And it is eye-opening.
It was a witch hunt.
It's certainly, at the very least.
And by the way, speaking of the court, I read that the guy who wrote the thing about putting the citizenship question on and the census, he's now a clerk for Alito.
Well, of course he is. Hillary was not wrong about the vast right-wing conspiracy.
Please.
It's really...
Please.
It's endless.
Well, look what they're trying to do now. The administration is trying to make it easier to skirt the contraception mandate under the Affordable Care Act. They want employers to be able to exclude women from obtaining contraception, saying you can go get them at a family planning clinic.
No,
overwhelmed family planning clinics.
They do not like contraception. Yes.
Now, you know, I have a sense. All you have to do is cite your sincere religious belief as an employer. You don't have to be a religious employer like the nuns. I think I have a sincere religious belief that these bigots don't have hearts and shouldn't get cardio care.
Okay, let's move on to politics. First, a correction or a semi-correction. I posited last week that the new representative from Kansas, Sharice Davids, might be a Harvard Law School graduate. Wrong, Cornell.
Okay.
Still in the Ivy League. And I'm sorry to see that Gina Ortiz Jones, the last lesbian congressional candidate, lost a very tight race in Texas. You made a valiant effort, and I hope you go on to do more.
But you can vote this week if you live in Mississippi on November 27th. You've got a runoff for the U.S. Senate pitting Democrat Mike Espy, a former agriculture secretary.
Yes.
Yes. Against Cindy Hyde Smith. Let's run Cindy's picture from 2014 in Confederate regalia.
Is it? I thought it was 2004. Maybe I have
you know,
that wrong.
Her Facebook page said 2014. The story said 2004.
Okay.
I fixed it.
Whatever.
Anyway, he would be the first black senator since Reconstruction. She would be the first woman from Mississippi.
Well, tell us what her caption on that picture was. You can put the picture up again.
She said,
those pictures up.
This is Mississippi history at its best.
That's Confederate regalia,
now,
folks.
Espy got 30% of the white vote. Needs 30% of the white vote to win. He got 21% in the first round.
Well, I'm not highly optimistic, but then again, I didn't think Doug Jones could beat Hoosie Watson in Alabama either. So I'm there, Mike Espy.
We've forgotten his name already.
We try. In California, we have our first out statewide elected official. Richard Lara has been elected as state insurance commissioner. We have a picture of him somewhere. There he is. We have a new governor of Colorado. We have a couple of attorneys general, lesbians in Michigan and Massachusetts. But in California, this is the first statewide elected out gay official.
You can look at all the out gay elected officials at victoryfund.org/results 2018. Of the 432 LGBTQ candidates on the ballot, 244 won.
56.5%. That's a very good record.
Vast majority were Democrats. In San Diego, 3 of the 9 council members are now gay, and it makes it the most of any major city percentage-wise.
Yes, not the small cities that have all gay city councils. All right. Also in California, Ahmad Zara has been elected to the Fullerton, California City Council. He is the first elected out gay Muslim to any office. We have a picture of him, too. There he is, Ahmad Zara. Congratulations to you. And Richard Lara, of course, is Mexican-American. We are electing a diverse universe of people.
And you have to love what's happened in Orange County, which was absolutely the most Republican area of California, all represented by Democrats now in the Congress. Included, that's where Bob Dornan was from.
Mm-hmm. All right. And I'm particularly taken by the picture of the three new members of the Florida legislature and the partners of two of them. The first out gay members of the Florida legislature. On the left, we have, to read my handwriting. All right, Jennifer Webb is second from the left. Her wife, Cynthia Warnon, is on the far left. In the middle is out gay African-American Chevron Jones. And then on to the right of him is Latinx Carlos Guillermo Smith with his fiance, Jarek Mediavilla. These three in the middle there are the first out LGBTQ legislators in Florida, a diverse bunch, and congratulations to all of them.
And someone who is obviously homosexual or bisexual who was not going to be in the state legislature in Ohio is Wes Goodman. He's anti-gay, anti-abortion, and he was caught having an affair with a man in his office. He announced his resignation. It was apparently a consensual affair, but inappropriate.
Well, that also brings us to the poor Cross Coburn in Groves, Texas.
Yes.
19 years old, out gay city council member in Texas. We have a picture of him.
Yes.
There he is. And someone found online some nude pictures on Grindr.
Yeah.
He's out. He's 19. He's advertising for dates on Grindr. Well, this was too much for Groves, Texas. They don't like this at all. And so he hadn't done anything wrong. He hadn't been accused of anything. But he has been recalled by the voters and has lost his seat on the city
council.
He's
contesting, it may be too late, the validity of the signatures on the recall petitions. And he wants the state attorney general to investigate who sent the photos. He believes it was Mayor Bailey and Councilmember Hollier who did him in, and he had refused to resign when all this came out earlier.
Now, also in the political world, big announcement, Chad Griffin, the president of the Human Rights Campaign, is quitting. He has been there for 7 years.
I wouldn't call it quitting as much as moving
resigning,
on.
Resigning, yeah. Yes. 7 years. At a salary of $500,000 a year, age 45, he's going to stay on until they find a new new president. They expect that to take till the end of the year or so.
I've been fairly critical of HRC over the years, but I think they did a good job of ginning up the LGBT vote around the country this year.
And I also think he listened to people, including me, who said to him, no more of this halfway measures on non-discrimination. You have to do a full-fledged non-discrimination law for sexual orientation and gender identity. We have to be in all the civil rights laws. You have to fix all the civil rights laws. You have to do the whole package. And he did work with a consortium of civil rights groups because there's some laws that don't cover women adequately or cover race adequately, and they all got together and wrote the Equality Act, which fixes all of it.
And their daily AM Equality news feed, which we rely on here to some extent,
is
very full of transgender news as well.
But here's what he's going to do. He is going to go work for a presidential candidate. He came out of politics and press relations in California. He's close to Kamala Harris, so there's a lot of speculation that he's going to work for her. But it really, presumably, whoever the Democrats nominate, he will work for, or he could run for office himself. But he is going to move on to bigger things.
And also moving in, the Transgender Legal Defense Fund has a new executive director, transgender Andy Mara. We have a picture. Has served at Arcus, GLSEN, GLAAD, and the Korean Community Development Group, No Dutal, on the board of Freedom for All Americans. There
congratulations
she
to
is.
Andy. All right, now, we are not happy to hear about this guy, Benjamin Matthews.
No.
From Arkansas. He is a menacing-looking dude, and it turns out he, in the space of about 3 days, made at least 40 life-threatening phone calls, death threats, to CNN anchor Don Lemon.
I think he's a bit addled. He even tried to get the operator at CNN to go in with him on the murder of Don Lemon.
He's also made threatening calls to Chuck Schumer, Maxine Waters, MSNBC as a whole, I guess. Michael Avenatti, Planned Parenthood. So yeah. He's been arrested.
Let's go back to Congress for a second.
Okay.
It looks like Pelosi's going to get in again as the speaker. Martina Navratilova this week wrote, go figure, a man loses and keeps his place, Chuck Schumer, and a woman wins and gets they try to boot her.
She wasn't the only one who said that.
Well, anyway, maybe she was retweeting, but she said, but she put her name on it, Martina Navratilova.
Well, as long as we mentioned Schumer, should we do the lesbian wedding news in his family?
Sure.
So Chuck Schumer is someone that we've demonstrated against for years because he voted for the Defense of Marriage Act.
Which twice outside his house in 1996, where he came out and yelled at us and we yelled at him.
That wasn't where he voted. It's where we demonstrated.
Right.
But and I yelled at him at a Lambda dinner, and the community was angry at him for a long time because he was just a craven coward about all
of
this.
And he sold the Democratic Party out to Wall Street and apparently to Facebook.
Yeah, well, and Facebook has been the latest thing. Well, it turns out, da-da-da-da-da, he has a lesbian daughter who works for Facebook. Now, I think we've shown this first picture before of Chuck with his daughter on the left and her fiancé on the right marching in the New York City Pride Parade.
Her name is Elizabeth Weiland and the daughter's name is Allison.
Yeah, and Allison on the left, Elizabeth, known as Biz, I think, on the right. And so we gave him credit for coming around and marching with his lesbian daughter in the Pride Parade. And now the women are married, and there they are in their wedding attire, getting married this past weekend in Brooklyn.
And not only did Allison get a job at Facebook, but Chuck got a $50,000 donation from Facebook for defending the indefensible.
Yeah, we'll see.
I mean,
where
it really is a scandal at this point,
yeah,
what he did in covering this up when they were when they were hiring a Republican operative to smear George Soros.
I have one nice thing about Facebook. They took down the page of Peter LaBarber, the Americans for Truth and Homosexuality, who has become a monster over the years with his diatribes against us. So Facebook finally decided that was a little too much hate speech for them.
And we tried to get Michelle Obama in here, but we did read about how
we saw her on Ellen.
Talked about how when the Obergefell decision went down and you saw the White House lit up in rainbow colors, she and Malia, the daughter, got so excited, they ran outside past the Secret Service agents.
Ran outside. She said it took her 15 minutes to get past them. They had to get, they ran into locked doors. They couldn't get out at first.
They didn't join the crowd, but they stood on the side of the White House because they were just so excited. There were a lot of people outside the White House celebrating, and she stood out of view, and that was the way that they celebrated.
And of course, that was the same day that there was the very moving, heart-wrenching funeral in Charleston, South Carolina, for the parishioners killed by Dylan Root. And yeah. So she points out what a poignant day it was to have been in yes. Charleston earlier in the day, where Barack was singing Amazing Grace, and then to come back from the White House and find these huge crowds outside celebrating marriage equality at the, from the Supreme Court. And we got one more wedding to tell you about, and that is a former Dallas Cowboys linebacker, Jeff Rohrer. There he is in action in the mid-80s. He was a very successful linebacker for the Cowboys. Well, he's retired, of course, now. And now he is married, Joshua Ross, who is an esthetician to the stars, a skincare expert. He works on a lot of the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills or Orange County or something. And so they got married this week. Rohrer is now an award-winning producer of TV ads. And they have a lovely story, and the NFL is being very supportive of their wedding. He is certainly the first ex-NFLer to marry, I think.
I guess so, since I remember when Dave Coppay was the first to come out post-career. We mentioned that the United States House, of course, you know it's been taken over by the Democrats, and the majority is going to create an independent diversity office in January. They're going to ban discrimination, I guess again, on the basis of sexual orientation. And they're also going to change the rule banning hats, because one of the Muslim women who was elected needs her headwear. But the thing is, they're only going to allow religious headwear, which I think is wrong. If you're going to change it for hats, anybody should be able to wear whatever hat they want.
What about those African-American women who are always wearing big hats? They don't wear them
on the floor of the Congress?
Floor?
I guess not.
Okay.
But why not?
All right. No,
and of course, I assume the other side will start wearing MAGA hats.
Why not? All right, I want to hopscotch a few stories. A new study out of HRC and the University of Connecticut have been studying trans youth. This latest report is the expansion of an earlier one. Three-quarters of the trans youth say they feel unsafe at home and hear negative comments from their family, twice as likely to be sexually assaulted or raped. Less than a quarter feel they can be themselves or be safe at school, and half of them never use school restrooms. And the conclusion of this report is that these kids need help now, immediately. This is not some theoretical, soft issue. This is an emergency right now to get these kids help.
Right. The Williams Institute found that 19% of LGB people have guns in our homes versus 35% of non-LGB people, and we're also more likely to support gun control.
A terrible story happy ending story in New York State. A young lesbian in college at Canisius College came out to her parents, who told her, "We're rejecting you. We'll have nothing to do with you if you don't come home and go to conversion therapy." And she said, "No way am I going to conversion therapy." So they cut off all contact and all financial support. So then her friends at college did a GoFundMe kind of thing, raised a lot of money for her, but she's a student athlete, and the NCAA then said they were cutting her off from any ability to compete because she was getting outside financial help. And then her friend said, "Who are you kidding? That's ridiculous." And so the NCAA reconsidered and ended up saying, "No, we see your circumstances. We support you. This is good."
That's nice.
So happy ending.
Not so nice. You know,
we
had an election on November 6th, but some of the Republican legislatures lost their supermajorities. So they still have majorities, so they're trying to do all kinds of crap. Ohio is passing draconian anti-abortion bills.
Oh,
I mean, they
horrible.
Want to ban it entirely. New Mexico is looking to overturn a statutory ban on abortion, so that if SCOTUS, the Supreme Court, overturns Roe, they'll have it. And that's something we have to do on the marriage thing. We have to get the states to do that. And then Republicans in Michigan, Wisconsin, North Carolina are doing horrible, horrible things while they still have power. So pay attention and try to stop it if you can.
Nice story from Texas, where the Texas A&M Student Senate has passed a resolution supporting the LGBT Resource Center, which is interesting because a couple of years ago, they were trying to destroy the student center. But now they've turned around. They're supporting, the resolution supports the Resource Center, supports LGBT students, administration and faculty, appreciates alum who have worked on these issues, and also supports gender-neutral bathrooms.
Democrats picked up 12 seats in the Texas legislature, and one of the ones who just was certified as losing was Ron Simmons in the House. He was the bathroom bill author, and he was upset by Democrat Michelle Beckley, who in a debate called his bill cow manure.
That's Texan.
She wasn't shying away from it.
Texan.
In Brooklyn, Brandon McNamara, who was the suspect in the Williamsburg attack in September of a gay couple, where he really beat the hell out of them and knocked them unconscious, was charged with second-degree assault as a hate crime.
And we have learned this week of a new video game that is, to call it heinous would be a compliment. It's put together by Christopher Cantwell. He's one of these neo-Nazis who was a ringleader at Charlottesville. And he has something called the Radical Agenda. And they have published this neo-Nazi video game in which one of the characters is Richard Spencer. You can be Richard Spencer, and you can shoot LGBT people, Jews, and journalists to save Trump. It's called Angry Goy 2.
God.
I watched a couple of frontline documentaries on the neo-Nazi terrorists in this country. It is very scary. And the idea that the federal government is making all these claims about ISIS, which is nonsense, and they're completely ignoring this extremely violent movement in our country where people are arming themselves and going out to do these lone wolf shootings like the Pittsburgh synagogue. This is an ongoing plot.
I don't think we did enough about this under the Democrats. I think they, you know, under Eric Holder. But, I mean, they're only doing a little bit, and it's scary. These are the people who are trying to hurt us.
And you might want to check out a new iTunes podcast series, Unerased, the History of Conversion Therapy in America.
Okay.
And I don't know who to congratulate. David Hockney's Portrait of an Artist, Pool with Two Figures, has become the highest selling picture at auction by a living artist, $90 million.
It features his lover, Peter Schlesinger. It was once owned by David Geffen.
People call it mysterious.
I don't think it's mysterious.
It's beautiful.
I love that picture. Yeah. It was at the MoMA exhibit on Hockney. Yeah.
It's lovely, great, but I wouldn't call it all that mysterious.
All right, international news.
Yes, it's whipping along.
Well, it was nice to see that Trump got blocked in his by a federal judge, an Obama judge, his bid to deny asylum to those crossing the southern border, Mexico there. That's a positive. There was a couple down there who had a commitment ceremony.
I think there were seven couples in Tijuana of the LGBT contingent in the refugees, La Comunidad, I think they call themselves. They had some,
they love each other.
And they're not real marriages. They're not legal marriages. They're symbolic. Symbolic weddings.
Maybe in God's eyes. Actually, Mexico doesn't recognize religious marriage.
I was happy to see 80,000 people turned out in Chile for the Basta de Blah Blah march in favor of marriage equality.
Because that's what they're saying the government is full of.
Enough.
Blah Blah.
Enough of the blah, blah.
The United States tried to water down a UN resolution on containing sexual harassment and violence against women. It took European countries, and Israel, by the way, to beat back the U.S. attempt to hurt reproductive health.
Aren't we charming? So this weekend, Taiwan will vote on five potential resolutions, two on whether or not to teach LGBT stuff in school curricula.
Or not.
I said whether or not.
Yes.
And three on whether or not to do civil unions, marriage, none of the above, whatever.
Well, the worst we're going to come out with on the relationship side is civil unions. And if we lose, if that's what they adopt, then we can go back to court and try to get it out of the court.
Yes, 100,000 people showed up in Taipei, Taiwan, to rally for LGBT rights for marriage. Also on marriage, Costa Rica, the Constitutional Court finally published its pro-marriage ruling. Now the clock starts ticking. It's going to take 18 months to come into effect. The government could do it a little faster. And the president is promising an executive order that gives family housing bonuses rights to same-sex couples, but I don't think they're going to fully implement this immediately.
In China, an erotic novelist called Liu, L-I-U, was jailed for 10 years for including gay male sex in her novel, Occupation. She was she has filed an appeal. Apparently porn is illegal there, but social media is lighting up and saying, this is a bit much for a novel.
And in Ukraine, 100 violent right-wingers broke up a march in Kiev of 40 people marching for trans rights. The police could not contain it.
Whereas in Jakarta, 7 trans people were told to leave their building by local residents. They were accused them of prostitution. They say, we haven't broken any rules or laws, but they're being tormented.
In Nigeria, a court has rejected the attempt of a lesbian NGO to register. In other countries, these groups have to register with the government. Lesbians Equality and Empowerment Initiatives was rejected on the grounds that same-sex marriage is not legal in the country. Therefore, any LGBT group cannot register as an NGO.
On the other hand, in India, where they've declared sodomy to be legal now, they're now featuring gay contestants on their elevator pitch dating show, a first.
On MTV India. And what they do is they have these quick dates in an elevator. Like, one guy gets in the elevator, and then one at a time, 10 other guys come in and make their elevator pitch to him to go out on a date.
Oh, it's finally dawning on me why they spell it differently. Elevator. That's what they call it. In Australia, a wedding magazine called White Magazine was out of business because they wouldn't cover gay stuff, gay weddings, and they said they experienced a flood of judgment, and the advertisers withdrew, so they're out of business.
In San Marino, the tiny country in Europe with a population of 32,000, they have approved civil unions for both gay and straight couples.
In New Zealand, a lot of turmoil over the Pride March. The police were excluded in uniform, so the defense forces dropped out, major sponsors pulled out in Auckland, and it's a mess.
We'll have to keep an eye on that. In Malaysia, the government censorship board has cut 4 gay scenes, a total of 20 minutes from Bohemian Rhapsody, even though, as you will hear in a few minutes, it is the highest grossing queer film ever in this country or around the world.
And in Toronto, there's an all-boys school, basically 7 through 12, St. Michael's Catholic School, where student football players were expelled and charged with gang assault for broom raping a boy. 6 were arrested. They were caught on video. And then another video came out showing the basketball players slapping the skin of a boy clad in wet underwear, and 4 students were expelled for that. Catholic education.
Human race. In Argentina, a congressman, Leon, I really must write bigger.
I don't have it.
Oh, no, he's the one who came out with a kiss picture with another guy on Instagram. Gerson? No, I've got that wrong. I'm going to change my handwriting.
Okay.
All right, that's what I've got for international news. AIDS news.
Well, World AIDS Day is December 1st, and there are events all over the world, so check it out online.
We'll tell you more about that next week as we approach it and tell you about some local events.
Right, and Day Without Art is going to have this movie, Alternate Endings, Activist Risings, and that's going to be shown all over the country. And
it's a series of short movies.
I'll send the link in our email.
Okay. The New York School of Medicine has done an analysis of the National Survey on Drug Use and Health and has found that opioid misuse is highest among bisexual people, particularly women, that they're so under assault and so stressed in a world that really doesn't accept them. That they, by some small margin, we're not talking vast differences here, are more likely to get caught up in opioid misuse.
Now, they did this study, are you finished?
I got one more.
They did a study out of Northwestern on the effect of a thing called Project Life Skills, a peer intervention for young trans women, and they feel that they were able to actually reduce the prevalence of HIV. Apparently, transgendered women have 34 times the rate of HIV among all adults. Talk about stress. They used to, you know, these sessions. What I didn't see in the study, I mean, they mainly were able to get condom use up, but they didn't talk about introducing PrEP among these folks. So that was a concern.
And in New York State, lest you think activism is dead, ACT UP New York and Physicians for a National Healthcare Plan and the New York State Nurses Association and the Democratic Socialists went up to Troy, New York, which is a hike from New York City, to demonstrate at a right-wing conference that is people organizing, health insurers who are organizing against single-payer health care. And the activists did a great job of interrupting
that.
Well,
we have a very short window in New York, now that we have a Democratic State Senate starting in January, to pass universal health care, and that's the one that's the heavier lift. They'll do the easier things like codify abortion rights, which they should, and pass GENDA, I hope, the Gender Expression Non-Discrimination Act, but that's the big, and we need those, but we also need universal health care in New York.
Did you see the trans military documentary on Logo? I did. It was terrific. It's really, really good. It's really worth watching. It profiles four trans members of the military in various different situations. And it's available on demand on Logo, if you have the on-demand function, through December 19th. So I would highly recommend taking a look at that.
Didn't we have that filmmaker in 100 years ago?
I don't
think
so.
Talking about it? Okay.
Fiona Dawson?
Yeah.
I don't
know
remember
I spoke
that,
to her.
But it's...
Maybe I just met with her.
Maybe. And I'm very excited because one of my favorite shows in the last few years was Jude Law as the Young Pope.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
They're making a new one, The New Pope. He will come back as... presumably the same person, but with a new title on the show called The New Pope.
It was wild.
Yes, it's on HBO, and they're filming it now. And
wasn't he a right-winger?
The Pope.
Pope,
yeah. kind of.
Cigarette-smoking, sexual
It was
Pope.
Wild. It was wild. And he was quite a wacky guy. So I'm planting myself in front of HBO until they bring me that show.
Good for the church or bad for the church?
You tell me. On Empire, we've talked about Jussie Smollett and his gay journey and now dating a guy with HIV and his mother freaked, but now she's getting educated very fast. It's a little quick. But the story this week was that he refused to have a white boyfriend, that he saw a real need for the audience to see two black men together, which I think is brilliant and wonderful, and congratulations to him for standing firm on that, and that is the situation now on Empire.
And Celine Dion has come out with a gender-neutral clothing line, folks. Celine
Jeans?
Dion.
And the movie Fantastic Beasts, The Crimes of Grindelwald is drawing a little controversy. Because it mostly, you know, this is a Harry Potter spinoff and or sequel or whatever. And Grindelwald is a character who was involved with Dumbledore. And J.K. Rowling said that Dumbledore, after she wrote the books, was gay. Well, so the big question was, would they appear as a couple in this movie? And it turns out that they're very cautious about it. They tiptoe around it. They describe them as like brothers, only closer. And by the way, Grindelwald is Jude Law. who's getting around.
Well, this is the movie with Ezra Miller, who
exactly.
we are going to talk about with our guest, Rob Shooter.
Yes. And they evidently shot some sexier scenes with the two of them, with Grindelwald and Dumbledore, but they cut them. They cut.
Chicken. They well, Hollywood, I mean, as Rob tells us, it's yeah. all about money.
Yeah.
And it's a shame that you think you can't make money with us.
Well, they're probably not making a lot of money with Can You Ever Forgive Me, which I saw. You saw it and talked about it yeah. a week or two ago, and I saw it. Melissa McCarthy is a lesbian writer.
Who hangs out at Julius's.
Yes, Lee Israel. And I liked it. And I liked the fact that Jane Curtin and Anna Deavere Smith were in it looking like older women with a lot of wrinkles. And I thought that was an unusual and brave choice. But I was particularly happy, of course, to see Justin Vivian Bond and Steven Spinella
yes,
in the movie. That was very
absolutely.
Heartwarming.
And we're going to see Matt Smith, who you saw in The Crown as Prince Philip, is going to be Mapplethorpe due in March. The dramatic film about him. He was also Doctor Who years ago.
Oh, that's playing film festivals.
Yep. It's not out until March
in
wide release.
I'm eager to see that.
Not out. Well, Mapplethorpe was quite a character.
He certainly was. That's one way of describing it. Well, also quite a character, that's a great segue, is our guest this week. You've seen him on this show several times, sometimes co-hosting, sometimes as a guest, Rob Shooter. And we just did an interview with him, and it's a lot of fun. So here is our interview with one of our favorites, Rob Shooter, with a new radio show.
And coming soon to a radio near you is Radio Rob.
Well, not just a radio, or he'd be out of business in a second. Hi, Rob.
Hello, hello. Thank you for having me back. It's been a while. Good to see you both.
Why are you here?
I'm here to give you all the gossip, and also to have a new radio show launching. You can find out all the details on naughtygossip.com, an hour live every day of this annoying voice, forgive me.
And Monday through Friday.
Monday to Friday.
At what time?
3 to 4. But then the interesting thing about it is the people I'm working with is afterwards, you can listen to it as a podcast. You can listen to it on demand. So if you're driving home or on the train or have nobody that night to talk to, I'm there.
Let's give the folks a sample of the kind of thing they might hear.
Let's pressure's on. Let's do it.
I'm dying to hear about this new movie, The Favourite.
The Favourite is a new movie about Queen Anne. It's not out yet, but it's coming out in a couple of days, a couple of weeks. Phenomenal. So they take the Queen Anne story, and most of it is historically accurate. She had a really tortured life.
Didn't she lose like
17 children. 17 children. She lost her husband. She had 17 rabbits, which she really did in many ways to replace the children. Later on in life, she's alone. She's in the palace.
Played by
Olivia.
Yes. Forgive me, I should know that. Phenomenal British accent.
That's
probably going to get nominated for this. It's a role
but
of a lifetime.
But she has female lovers who are fighting over her.
That's where we're getting to it. So her husband's gone, her children's gone. She has female lovers. So within the palace, several of her ladies in waiting become more than that. And then amongst the ladies in waiting, there's a battle to see who will be the favorite.
I can't wait.
Listen, Emma Stone is in it. Ultimately, she does pretty well on the favoritism charts, and it's easy to understand why. It's a terrific movie, and it's fearless.
Coleman.
Yes.
Olivia Colman.
And it's a fearless movie. It is very sexual. They do not shy away.
Love that.
And it's erotic and sexual, and I think you should all check it out. It's a great movie.
No question. Well, let's stay in Britain for a moment here. Paul McCartney,
I love this story. Paul McCartney's becoming a regular at a gay bar here in New York City. Paul has shown up now at least two, maybe three times at Club Cummings. This is a bar on the Lower East Side. Anderson Cooper's ex-boyfriend runs it, and also Alan Cumming. If you go in there, Alan is behind the bar. The twice, three times I've been there, Alan's behind the bar serving vodka sodas. And so,
and now Paul McCartney's in the corner?
It's an interesting little connection. So Alan did cabaret with Emma Stone. Paul and Emma Stone were friends, so they all went in together one night. And Paul, in the city, is probably fed up with these fancy places he goes, or these boring bars or places. Aren't we all? And so Paul went in a couple of nights ago. He went back, no security. Paul and a couple of friends in the corner singing along to the karaoke, and get this, he paid for his drinks.
It's a tiny little place, but a lot of fun. That's where we saw Michael Musto do his
It's become like the coolest new sort of like neighborhood bar, wherever, whatever neighborhood you live in. It starts a little late, like, you know, it's sort of around 10-ish it gets going.
Yeah, this is my problem.
But it's a cool place downtown.
Paul McCartney is coming, and Adam Rippon is going.
Adam's going. So Adam Rippon has announced he's going to retire. He's no longer going to skate professionally. However, we haven't seen the last of him. Well, he's not going to compete anymore. He has a long future in the ice shows that we see at the Garden and all those other venues. I'm told, too, NBC really like him. They've done several projects with him, and now they're even talking about developing a TV show, a talk show with him.
CBS had him on this week, and he looked at us and said, look yourself in the mirror and say, I'm a winner.
He's charming, and the way that he announced this retirement is, I think, really lovely. He wrote a letter to himself as a young guy, and he told himself to tell yourself you're a winner when you don't feel like it. He said at one point in his life, he had to decide between buying groceries or paying to go to the skating rink.
Yeah.
He also, too, he'd tell himself as a young guy that your eyebrows look fabulous when you wax them. So he also has a really good sense of humor.
Well, that's what I like about him. He has a great sense of humor. He's very smart and very cheeky, and
Johnny Weir, you should be careful, because now Adam's in the TV business. Well, I don't want to cause drama between you two, but Adam's not going anywhere.
So now the question is, are we ever going to see another Sex and the City movie?
We are not going to see this movie. So it's amazing how far they got into this movie. The script is done. It was ready to for the movie part three.
After number two, which was so awful.
Was not good, but made a lot of money. Oh. And as we know from movies, it's about money rather than reviews or taste.
I thought both the movies were terrible.
They were both not great, but they made a lot of money.
Yeah.
So they had the script for number three. Get this, the script has now been leaked. Early on in the movie, very early on, Mr. Big was going to die of a heart attack in the shower. And the whole movie was going to really be about Sarah and finding love again after loss. The other ladies were not really in it. And this is one of the reasons that Kim Cattrall and her agents, her managers were like, she's not making this one. She's not really in it. There's nothing great there. So weirdly, though, it's blowing up on Twitter now that Kim has become the hero. And people are thanking Kim for not killing Mr. Big. Because if Kim had made the movie, Big would be dead.
She's also become a very serious actress, and Cynthia Nixon has become a political leader.
That's right, But I think Cynthia was going to go back. I think Cynthia was going to go back. Charlotte was going to go back. Kristen Davis. Samantha, Kim Cattrall said no, and now when I saw the script, it's about Sarah. Sarah's the boss.
Well, speaking of high-grossing movies, Bohemian Rhapsody is...
It is now the number one grossing queer movie of all time. Number two is The Birdcage with Nathan Lane and Robin Williams.
Appalling.
But number one now is Bohemian Rhapsody. And it's actually the second highest grossing rock sort of musical of all time. Number one is Straight Outta Compton.
Also, not the most affirming gay character.
Yeah, it's a strange movie. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was terrific to hear the music and see this character dancing up there. I hear there's a little bit of controversy. Adam Lambert really wanted this part. Adam's on tour with Queen.
Yes,
and so I think he thought he had a chance of getting this. He didn't. And one of the difficulties with this movie, and I think we're going to see it with the Michael Jackson musical that's coming out, the estate owned the rights. And you could not do this movie we couldn't do it with the music without the estate.
Yeah.
And so the estate wanted it to be quite soft and quite gentle about maybe the most interesting aspects of Freddie's life.
Now, the other thing that's come up this week is all these wacky stories about people and their relationships. We have Ezra Miller saying he's in a polycule.
I do indeed.
I think we have a sweet picture of him. There he is. And Frankie Grande says he's in a thruple.
A thruple.
There he is in the middle. And Jaden Smith keeps trying to get us to believe that he's in a relationship with Tyler, the Creator.
I'd like to think Jaden shows what a long way we've come. Because normally, when a celebrity or a celebrity's kid came out, we would hold the cover of Us Weekly or People magazine. We'd go nuts about it. This poor kid now has come out twice, and we still aren't paying him enough attention as he wants.
I mean, Ezra Miller.
He wore skirts for years to get attention.
Ezra Miller, you know, is basically saying, I'm trying to find queer beings who understand me as a queer being off the bat, and I form a group of sexual partners. I think we used to call those F-buddies, basically, right?
That's what we used to call them. Frankie Grande, too, he was at the Bette Midler Halloween party, and he told a reporter from Us Weekly, he broke this story there on the carpet, and she told me she didn't realize what he had said until she got, it was so noisy, she had to get home and listen to her tape of her recording of herself, and she was like, what did he just say? He sort of dropped it very casually. He seems to be really, really happy. And I found out too this week, which I think is hilarious, Ariana Grande has just figured out that she's living in an apartment next to the Eagle, a gay bar here in the city, and now she understands why so many gentlemen are wearing leather chaps on her street. $60,000 a month she's paying.
Oh my
next
God.
To the Eagle.
Oh my God. All right. Well, you two have a recommendation for the best thing on Broadway at the moment.
We went, I think I can speak on behalf of us, we went not knowing we were going to.
Not together.
Not together. We should go together. We went not knowing whether we would love this. There's a new musical on Broadway called The Prom. It has so many stereotypes and it has so many reasons for us not to like it. It's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. Should we take a look?
They turn into human beings.
Yeah. Let's get a little of the singing and dancing from The Prom.
Build a prom for everyone. Show them all. It can be done if the music blares and no one cares. Your unruly heart, let's build it now. And people see how the world could one day be. It might come true.
Musical had me in tears. Now I know it doesn't look.
I cried for 20 minutes.
I was a mess.
I'm going to take it on faith.
Now we've hardened you about that. I mean, now you know.
I know. But I just, you know, the trailer is kind of homogenous.
I get it. There's every reason not to like it. Go see it. It's a phenomenal.
Okay. Well. I'm more interested in listening to you online on Radio Rob.
You're awfully kind. You go to naughtygossip.com, get all the details, please.
Naughtygossip.com.
Naughtygossip.com.
Thank
Rob
you, Rob.
Shooter, cheers. You're doing the best.
Thanks for all the news. We'll see you soon.
Can't wait for Radio Rob. One more note about Ezra Miller, who is in Fantastic Beasts. He says, the people that he goes out with, I feel like I'm married to them 25 lifetimes ago from the moment we meet. That's the people that he goes out with. He's quite, to use the word again, character.
Yeah, we all try that. And then it turns out that maybe it's not quite so faded. I made a quick pass last week at telling you about something that I want to do better justice to. At the Japan Society, there is an extensive exhibit by an artist who's very well known in Japan, Yasumasa Morimura. And there he is in front of one of his works. He does a lot of gender play in his work, and it's fascinating art and really impressive. And if you go to the Japan Society in New York through January 13th, you can see the exhibit by Yasumasa Morimura. Highly recommended. Check that out.
Hope you had a happy Thanksgiving. Or are
what
having
are
a happy Thanksgiving.
For?
I'm thankful for you, because this show, doing this show with you is a pleasure.
You've come to appreciate me on my weeks
Please.
Off.
No, yeah, absolutely.
Well, I appreciate you
and
in doing
love
this
our,
show.
We love our substitute co-hosts as well. We
and
love you.
Our staff and our Bill Bowman and Rich Speziale.
Absolutely.
Thank you for you and you, and we'll see you next week.